Recently, I had the pleasure of spending an afternoon with Phyllis Hyman. It was good to get to know the woman behind that captivating voice. While Phyllis has always had a loyal following, now that she's added this smash album to her credits, the whole world will get to know what her fans have known all along. Phyllis Hyman has an extraordinary talent. Phyllis Hyman is anything but a lonely lady. From the day she whispered her first note and the world discovered she could sing, music critics have used words like smoky, haunting, and even seductive to describe her amazing voice. Some have compared this exceptional sound to echoes of Nina Simone, Nancy Wilson, and Sarah Vaughan. Don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing. One thing is certain. Phyllis Hyman is gifted with a voice that, when coupled with imagination, can transport you to a swinging jazz club of the 1930s and 40s. A native of Philadelphia and splendidly over 6 feet tall, Phyllis is in constant demand and hard to catch up with.
You do about 125 live performances a year. Do you ever feel like it's just too much?
Sometimes, but of course I break it up with my lectures and involvement with cosmetic companies. And
who has influenced your style most?
It's hard to say. Two singers I remember listening to a great deal when I was younger was Nancy Wilson and James Brown, as far, you know, as far away as those two are in terms of styles. But James attracted me because of his roughness. He was exciting. And during the time when he was at the height of his career, had a hit out, seemed like every couple of months, and he owned radio stations, and he was a very powerful and rich man. And as a young girl, I wanted to be like him. I wanted to be powerful. I wanted to be in control. And then Nancy Wilson, I just thought she was the premier vocalist. I thought, if you can't sing like Nancy, don't bother. And of course, I didn't get in the business for a while because of that. I just thought she was the best singer ever. I sang in clubs and things like that, but I couldn't imagine being a professional singer because I didn't think I had anything to offer.
So you held back from...
Oh, I really did. I thought Nancy was the best.
I've been watching you for years, and I've just always been struck by your confidence. So it's amazing to me to hear that you didn't always feel confident, that you were fearful. What did you fear?
The fear was of not being good enough, not being pretty enough, not being thin enough. Well, I think a lot of girls go through that. I have just begun to put all of that aside, and I'm talking about just in the last year or two. Being with a record company that did not give me any attention started that ball rolling. And in most cases, these problems creep up because artists, unfortunately, are oftentimes concerned with being musically correct and having on the right clothes and the right makeup, and that's not enough. I stress learning the business backwards and forwards, being in control of what is going on in your life, being able to have people right that you can trust. When you're a woman,
you started out singing jazz, and today, how would you describe your musical style?
It's a combination. It's contemporary improvised. I never concentrated on jazz as a singer. I just, for some reason, had those inflections in my voice. I don't know where they came from.
So how is it having a relationship with a younger man?
No, I'm only kidding. Nice. No, it's nice. I don't know what to say. You know, it's funny. I always thought that I would never get involved with a younger guy. I figured I was too mature, I was too grown up. Boy, do I have a lot to learn. I had a little trick. You found a new chick.
1981, critics had a lot to learn about Phyllis Hyman's range when she was cast in Duke Ellington's Sophisticated Ladies. That same year, her performance earned her a Tony nomination and the Theatre World Award for Most Promising New Artist. How did appearing on Broadway in Sophisticated Ladies change your life?
It was so different than anything I'd ever done before. 8 shows a week, 2 on Wednesday and Saturday. It made a great difference in the way I approach the stage today. I have much more confidence when I hit that stage. Pretty much by the first year, I was a basket case. I was very nervous.
You mean the first year you were performing?
Yes, actually performing. I couldn't quite get it together. I just couldn't get it together. I was nervous. I didn't think I was that good. And when the Tony nomination came through and I won the Theatre World Award, I really felt like they gave it to me because there was no one else.
I end up like I start out, just crying. Crying my heart out. He don't love me like I love him. Nobody could.
For me to really become comfortable, to accept the fact that people liked what I did, not to question it again. I spent years questioning myself as opposed to dealing with the fact that people like it. They like it. They enjoy it.
Sponsored in part by the Coca-Cola Company and your local bottler of Coca-Cola Classics, and by Carson Products, the makers of Dark and Lovely. Ah, the pleasure of Dark and Lovely.